Good morning. All right, I want to invite y'all to sing with us. Let's stand together and sing, "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name."
Hace 10 años tuve la oportunidad de formar parte del primer programa de La Gran Aventura. Por la caja llegué a conocer a Dios. Fue por mi interés propio que quise conocer más de Dios, asistiendo a los cursos que enseñaban sobre La Gran Aventura. El mensaje que más se quedó profundo fue el de la crucifixión. Jesús había muerto por nuestros pecados. Fue la primera vez que leo un libro en el cual el héroe muere por el villano. Ayer fue un gran día para mí. O sea, me sentí alegre haber entregado diplomas, ver a niños que están en el programa La Gran Aventura. Los niños parecían de mi misma edad, la verdad. Me sentí tan alegre haberlos graduado, darles el Nuevo Testamento para que así logren ser alguien que sirve para Dios.
Father, thank you for just the honor it is to come together and to lift your name up and worship it in song. Father, we want to lift these up to you. We want to lift Dwight and Gail and Jan and his family up to you. Father, just be with them and wrap your loving arms around them as they, whether they're through the procedures and as they continue to grieve the loss of a loved one, Father. And just show your power, Father, through your encouragement, through your love, Father, and help that be evident in their lives. We ask that the gospel is proclaimed in all that we do. Father, thank you for your love that you show each and every day. Be with James this morning as he brings the message. Speak through him in the words that you want us to hear, Father, and open our hearts and minds to receive your word. Thank you again for your love, your mercy, and grace. It's in the name of your Son we pray. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and introduce him. Most of you know him. James Greer is our area director of missions, or area missionary, or the gopher, whatever you want. Yeah. No, he is our director of missions. You'll be blessed by his message this morning. Continue to pray for Norman and IB as they are hopefully relaxing, rejuvenating, and that the Lord will bless their time together as well, and then bring them back safely to us. James will be here this morning and this evening. And are you doing Wednesday night? And Wednesday night. So keep James in your prayer, James and Dana in your prayer. You should keep them in your prayers, our area director of missions, but keep him specifically in your prayers for today and for Wednesday night. I want to invite y'all to stand with me, and let's take a moment and welcome each other here.
Love somebody in the name of the Lord. Greet your neighbor with a smile. Let the love of Christ come shining through as you're walking down the aisle. For loving one another is the way of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, all are we.
Sing together.
Love somebody in the name of the Lord. Greet your neighbor with a smile. Let the love of Christ come shining through as you're walking down the aisle. For loving one another is the way of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, all are we. Washed in the blood and grounded in the word, living in salvation, full and free.
Amen. Y'all go ahead and be seated as we sing.
Great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages sent down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. God, you are my living hope. This is my Father's word, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines to me. And y'all stand as we sing the last. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget. And though the wrong seems all so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven. This is my Father's world. This is my Father's world. The battle done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. I try.
Father God, we just thank you for today. We thank you for this time where you allow us to come up here and worship you, Lord. Lord, we just pray for forgiveness of sin. We pray for those who are sick. Lord, we pray for those who have lost loved ones. We just pray for strength for them, Lord. I just pray that you draw them closer to you, Father. Father, we just pray for America. Pray for change in America. We have turned so far away from you, Lord. I just pray for forgiveness. Father, now as we take this offering, we just ask you to bless the gift and the giver, because we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Glad to be with you today. And this is good, Andy, because this gives me another hour to preach. Amen. Just this morning, so that you know what all is going on, I was given a piece of gum, and I was told by my mother never swallow it. So I'm going to tuck it down in my pants, and then Dana, don't wash these pants, because I'll forget to pull that out. All right, here we go. We're going to be in Luke, the 10th chapter this morning, verse 38 through 42. I will tell you, I've had several ask about how Mom's doing. She's listening right now via Facebook, I am sure. And she has been able to walk a little bit. She's not real happy with the food that they're serving there, but she's that gives her incentive to get out. So she'll work hard to get her body in the right spot. She would appreciate your prayers. I know that there are many others that have prayer needs this morning. I sure don't want to just focus on my mom, but that's near and dear to our family's heart. And so I would ask you to be praying for her and others in our church that's struggling, has some issues, things that they're working on. Isn't that right? So be praying for those you've heard about. Nestled in between two passages or two, there's two great sermons here. One is the Good Samaritan and one is the Lord's Prayer. And right in between those is a little package of a story about Mary and Martha. And you've heard this. If you're likened to me, you probably grew up hearing these stories. You probably heard this as a child. You probably had one of the felt screen things done in Sunday school for some of you. Some of you, you've had the little placards that were the 12 by 16 sheets that did pictures. And then for some of you, it's been a video presentation or a projector. And for some of us, it's been on a little Sunday school material that's been pressed out. And oftentimes, Martha gets a bad rap for being Martha, and Mary gets a good rap for being the listener. But I want you to know that the church without the Marthas would be in trouble today. But I also want you to know that there is a story, there is a relationship that is used and tied together within this story that helps you and I to become more like Jesus and better focused on the things that we need to be. Now, folks, I want you to understand, we don't have any preacher in the panhandle of Texas that's like Brother Norman. So if you come here expecting to hear Brother Norman, forget it. You're not going to get that. If you come here expecting to hear things that are input that's from my family and my life, and that's how I preach. I'm a storyteller. But I want you to realize that within this story, man, there's some deep stuff that is designed for the Christian to hear. And so today, I want us to read this scripture together. Now, I brought my key word study Bible. It is English Standard Version, and I know you probably got a little bit different version. That's okay. So read along with me, and I'll start at verse 38, chapter 10, Luke. Luke 10, verse 38. Now, as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village. And a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone. Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered, Martha, Martha. I'm not real sure how he did this. He could have done Martha, Martha. Or he could have said, Martha, Martha. Maybe he did it this way. Martha, Martha. You are anxious and troubled about many things. But one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion which will not be taken away from her. Now, I'd like to do a couple of things with this morning. And first off, I want us to be careful. Today, we measure the worth of each of us by how much or how busy we are. Have you noticed that? A lot of times when people look at you and they go, how you doing? Busy. Tired, worn out, been a rough, busy week. And you've had time to watch 4 or 5 hours of TV. You know, we oftentimes think that life is measured by how busy we are so that people know how good we are, how great we are. In fact, I want you to know that's even tucked down inside this scripture if you think about it, because I believe that Martha was telling Jesus at this point, she was saying to Jesus, hey, get my sister up off her duff and get her to help me. Look at where we're at with this. And I believe that Mary is sitting here and she's enthralled by the words. She's enthralled by the temperature of the situation. She's enthralled by the words that come out of Jesus' mouth and the story that he is telling. She is captivated by him. And Martha, now let me set some rules here. I did a little bit of back work, log work on this. I went back into it. I've not ever preached this sermon before. I bring that for you this morning. That I know of, I've never ever preached on this sermon. But I want you to realize that when I went back into some of the commentaries and was looking at it, it looks like there was around, remember the 72 that had returned that were faithfully serving? It looks like those 72 were there, plus some others. We think near 100 people were in that place. So it wasn't like Jesus and his 12 disciples. Are you with me? So now what would you do in that situation? Now I want you to understand that I am a Martha. I am the person that's going to hustle and rustle around to make sure everything's right and make sure everything's put together right. And in so doing, it is often easy for me to miss some of the very important relationships that are built by listening. I want you to recognize that if we do anything well for each other, it should be that word that's capitalized with the L, big L, listening to each other. Because a lot of times in today's society, have you noticed how we don't listen to each other? I'm a storyteller. I told you that already. I love to tell stories. In fact, I love to preach because I captivate. I get to hold. I get to get your attention. Unless you're like some that go to sleep on me during this time. And that's okay. I know y'all don't do that for Brother Norm, but you got a whole 45 minutes, maybe an hour, to grab a nap now. But let me hold you to something this morning. There's some nuggets of truth down inside this that you need to grab a hold of. If you don't need it, it's okay. But I know that I do. Because when I started reading about Martha, I recognized I am a Martha. And what are the negatives of Martha and what are the positives of Martha? What are the negatives of Mary and what are the positives of Mary? And I want to bring those to you this morning. First off, I want you to recognize a couple of things. I think first, Martha's home is open to people. She is making that a place that people can visit. She has made them welcome in her home. She has opened her arms and said, come. So there is a faith character that she has within her. So me being a Martha, I don't want to make it too dark about who Martha is because, see, I don't want you to paint a bad picture of me or other Marthas that are in this place. But we've got to get a male name to this somehow, because I don't like being called Martha. But I do want you to recognize that Marthas have some things within them that is so necessary for service unto the kingdom. So what did Martha do that was good? First, we see that she opened her home. What was the negative that she did when she opened her home? And that she focused on her own activity. If you're a Martha here today, if you're going to move around and focus on everybody's needs and everything that's going on, then make sure that you don't do so to your detriment. Focus back on where Martha is here. She's opened her home. She's been godly in that. But she wants everybody to know how maybe important she is. Oh, if we get focused on ourselves, what happens? We take our focus off of Christ and the cross. So I see that she often here in this circumstance was focused on her own activity and what she thought was important. Second, she wanted Jesus to see how important her task was. See, she had all those people in her house and she wanted them to be taken care of. And so to serve them and make sure that they were taken care of was of major importance. And I believe as I read this scripture, I started thinking, Martha welcomed him and his folks into the house. She knew who Jesus was. In fact, there is in the commentary some belief that it may have even been Lazarus' family that Mary and Martha there. If that is true, then they knew the power and the authority that Jesus had. Now you see all of a sudden why Mary becomes infatuated with listening to the authority of Jesus being spoken here. And I want to ask you a question this morning. I just want you to stew on it a little bit. I want you to think about it. I want you to put it in your little crock pot this morning and cook on it a bit about your own life. But in your life, what are the things that make you spend time with God? What are the things that infatuate you about Christ and His authority and the work that He has done in others, or maybe what He's done in your life in the past? And does it still draw you back to the place of sharing the gospel and opening up into the Word and listening to it and seeing what He has for you? You know, it gets real easy for us to forget about the power and the authority of God. And I believe that's what Martha had done at this moment. She knew too about the authority of God, if she was in fact who we think she is. Now, there's something else I want you to see. And that's the third thing. I think she lost sight of the important things that were going on in her house. Not too awful long ago, I was sitting down with my granddaughter, Adeline Marie Greer. And I looked at Addie, and she had been playing. We had kept them for her and her brother for a couple of days. And she has this high-pitched, toe-curling squeal that she does. I mean, it will set you on, it's like being sitting on Humpty Dumpty flipping over kind of thing. And I told her, I said, Adeline, don't squeal. Just calm, calm. Boy, they've been playing. So we have opened up an area, and they can do a full run through the kitchen, through the dining room, through the living room. And man, they can get it going. And then Landon Glenn Greer, my namesake, pulls, turns around and faces her, and every time he'd do it, she'd turn into that werewolf screech. So finally I looked at her and I said, Addie, if you scream one more time, Babu's going to paddle you. Babu is Swahili for grandfather, okay? Babu's going to paddle you. Sure as the world. They got to playing again, and it just squeaked out of her. I won't do that. I can't do that squeal. thank you. You'll be happy. Anyway, I looked at her and I said, time for paddling. She looked at me and she says, it just happened. Can you whoop something like that? Sometimes we get so focused on who we are that we unfocus on Jesus and it just happens. But let me take us back to where we probably need to do this morning, and that's to refocus on why he's there. What was the purpose of him being in her home? It was to bring. Now remember that he was bringing back the 72 and those that had been working in the ministry. There was over 100 people in the home. And here he is. He is pouring out himself. She does not know that he one day will be gone. She does not understand that probably. You know, most of us think nobody's going to be gone out of this building in the next 30 days. For the next week, we're going to get to meet each other again. But there have been many times that over a process of a week, somebody's been healthy, been here, and been gone the next. You know, she had no idea, I don't think. But how often is it that we forget that it's important to spend time with someone and learn about them and hear their story? And by the way, let me just tell you, even if the stories are over and over and over and over again, still listen. Still listen. Because you know what listening says? Listening says, I love you enough to listen. It's okay. Now here's Martha processing, wanting help, wanting to make things work. And here's Mary at the feet of Jesus. Martha's upset, looks at Jesus, get her up and get her to help me. And Jesus does his Martha, Martha. Now I want us to look at some little something tucked in here maybe. Hopefully I'm doing this justice. He says, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things. And then it takes a little turn right here, but one thing is necessary. It doesn't go into the troubled and anxious moments to deal with them. It says, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen a good portion which will not be taken away from her. In other words, she's taken on a point in her life where she's sitting, she's spending time with Jesus, and it will change her, and she will never be the same.
All right.
So let me ask you a couple of questions. What changes you to where you're never the same? What makes you so different in contact with Jesus that you'll never be like you were? What makes you want to be different? What makes you want to change in who you used to be to who you are today? What has made you that? And you say, I understand what you're saying, but you just don't understand my life. And I want you to know, I believe as I look at this scripture, it is the common life. We all have a common life. We understand each other's struggles. We understand what it is to pay bills. We understand what it is to shop. We now have an easier market thing with Walmart. We can just order what we want. That means we don't have to face people and talk to people and visit with people. What's going on with that? And I know it's easier because we do it. But here's the deal I want you to think about. Relationships mean everything in the world of Christianity. And if we don't talk to each other, we don't visit with each other, if we don't hit the commonalities with each other, then we miss the most important thing. And that was the thing that Mary was doing with Jesus as she spent time with him learning who he was. Now I want to take it another step. Will you take this with me? This is a little bit, I'm going to take a little license, just a little, and I still believe I can biblically back it up. But if I asked you to raise your hand if you had a Bible study every night or every morning this week, I'm not going to ask you to do that. Don't embarrass yourself. But I would bet today that there are many here that have not had any time with the Father this week. But they need Sunday so they can recharge till next Sunday. But that's not the way it's intended. Because, see, to be honest with you, we're supposed to be sitting at the feet of Jesus every day. Now, I want to just tell you, I'm not trying to scare you. I'm not even trying to get you to feel bad about yourself. The fact is, I want you to feel good about something today. Did you know you can't do a thing about last week? As screwed up as you have done it or I have done it, can we change it? No, we can't.
All right.
But what we can do is change from here and forward.
Right.
And folks, I just want you to know, I love how the Father forgives. His grace is forgiving.
Yes.
He is forever forgiving.
Yes.
I'm going to show you something tucked off inside this. I saw it when Jesus said, Mary has chosen the good portion. That word, portion, which will not be taken away from her. When I started digging on that just a little bit, I saw some things that you get what you put into something. There was a football, no football player loves to practice. Unless they crazy. They don't want to run those throw-up drills. You know what I mean? Nobody wants to run those crazy drills. No basketball player wants to do shuttles where they run to a point back and then the next point back, next point back, and then they're ready to puke. Nobody wants to do that. But to be honest with you, if they don't do it come game day, they run out of jet fuel come halftime, and then they're being stomped on by the other team that was resilient and stayed the mark and studied and did the work. So what I want you to see today is that a portion comes whenever you put effort into it. So you get a portion from Christ, and as you grow in knowledge and the base of knowledge, God gives you more of that portion. I believe there's not a way you can get too much from Him. He will feed you every time you set before Him.
All right. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
This way, Mary becomes important, not wanting to be important. She's not after importance. She's after knowledge. She's not after being a servant. She's after hearing how Jesus, the power that could raise Lazarus from the dead, could anoint her and talk to her and help her to become more of what He designed her to be. So first off, Martha lost focus on her own activity. She focused on her own activity. She thought her importance was more than it was. And third, she lost sight of the important things by prioritizing and out of focused it. Can I bring us into focus just a little bit this morning with about three little points? Here's where I want to go. First off, we often focus on our own activities, losing focus, losing sight of what is most important in life. So, how do you know what's important in life? I have a few little old cows, and I like to go out there when the cows and the calves are there, and the calves are jumping and running and playing, and they'll jump at anything. They'll see a piece of paper and they'll be jumping around it, and they're just happy. Life is good, and they have no idea what is going on. They just feel good. They want to jump. I get there. I go watch that whenever I can because I want to escape some of the world for a little bit. Now, some of you may do that in different ways. You may do that in a television show, then pick shows that are godly and representative of good things. But what I've noticed more about me in that when I get to minister to people and they minister back to me, and I get to talk to them and they get to talk to me, and when I listen, I have built a relationship that's more important than anything else. That relationship with people, it will go way beyond the grave. Do you understand that? So the room, the place that you are today, I encourage you to spend time with each other. Young people, spend time with these old people. These gray hairs, they hold a lot of wisdom. They got stories that you wouldn't believe if you just spend a little time listening. Old people, listen to each other. Don't just do all the talking like I do. I have to work on that. It's a pressure. I got to work on it. But listen to each other. Share the time. But let me get you another step deeper, and that is this. If you are in the family of God, then share the Christ-like things together. Spend time lifting up Christ and who He is and what He's done in you. Don't just escape life by talking and walk away with nothing that expresses who Jesus is in your life. I read a couple of things that I can do. I can get focused too much on me and not enough on Jesus. I can get too focused on me and not enough on you. I can become too critical of others, like Martha became of Mary. And when I become too critical of the Marys, I lose who I am as a Martha. And I don't want you to be like me. I want you to be like Jesus. And for me to help you be like Jesus, I need to be who Jesus made me to be. Last, have we or do we lose sight of our ultimate priorities? Here's the priorities: the cross, Jesus, the resurrection, the forgiveness, the hope, the grace, and just time that we can be with Jesus. I have three words written in my Bible at this juncture of my sermon. And here are the three words. Stop. You'll love this next one. Rest and listen. Stop, rest, and listen. When you are thinking about the next move to make on being a Martha, you forget about being the Mary. Each of us needs to have a little bit of both in our lives. We need to set before Jesus. So when's the last time you had just a good old-fashioned, open your Bible up, read two or three, four verses, five or six verses. Don't try and digest a whole book. And then ask God, what are you teaching me out of this? What do you want me to learn today? So here's my invitation to you today. I want to invite you to stop this morning. Take a moment. Don't worry about the roast burning. We're early. I want you to rest. Rest in the Lord. Rest in the moment with each other. Andy, I'll never forget my first pastorate. I didn't rest. I didn't know how to rest. I didn't know how to stop. I didn't know how to slow down. Dana would just shake her head at me. I'd do two or three laps around her. Stop, rest, and listen. Whenever I was taking an EMT class, there was three things that they taught you: airway, breathing, and circulation. I want to tell you that the church today is the same way. If the church is not having a good airway, if it doesn't listen to each other, if it's not airway, and if it's not breathing together, airway, if it's not breathing, if it doesn't have circulation, moving together, beating on the heartbeat of Jesus, doing what you're designed to do as a church, then it's dead. ABC, airway, breathing, circulation. We got to be airway, breathing, circulation church. And it doesn't mean central. It means every church in America that proclaims Jesus born again. Jesus born of a virgin, raised up from death for our sins, resurrected. Then it's time for us to sit at his feet, read his word, and get the breathing circulation going. This morning, if you've stopped just for a few minutes and you've just rested in the word, it won't be anything I've said. It will be something God's showing you already. Then listen, because he's trying to take you some steps. Our invitation is this morning. How's your circulation? How's your airway? How's your breathing?
All right.
Whenever I see somebody underwater, swimming from one spot to another spot, do y'all do what I do? Do you hold your breath? When I see somebody going through traumatic things, do you visit that with them? Did you know that's what God wants us to do with him? He wants us to experience life with him. So this morning, are you experiencing life? How's your airway? How are you relating? How's your breathing? That without breath, you die. Without circulation, you die. Have you stopped lately? Have you just took a moment to listen? So this morning, where are you? Now, there may be some of you here that has never asked Jesus to live in your heart. You don't understand this moment, this thing with Jesus that Mary was going through. But I tell you this morning, you can ask him to forgive you of your sins, live in your heart, and he will change you inside out. It'll make you new. But you have to be willing for him to change you. You have to be willing to make that step. That's one of the reasons we give the invitation, is so that you have an opportunity to come down and say, this morning I'm asking Jesus to live in my heart, forgive me of my sin. Will you be my church? Will you help me to stop and listen? Will you help me to hear? And that's why we go through this journey together. Maybe you have need of a church home. You hadn't made a church home yet, and you need one. You want to make that. This is a good place. This is my home. This is my church home. I grew up right there. I grew up in the old building, too. That's how old I are. I remember when the deck was sloped down so people wouldn't have to, they just had to get started back there and they could roll forward. Well, it's a little tougher today. You got to get up and walk it. Why do you need to walk it? Why is that important? First off, I just want you to know, if you'll not confess him before others, that means you're ashamed of him. And I'm just being honest with him. That means you really just too worried about what everybody else thinks.
That's right. Amen.
But this morning, to be honest with you, you have an opportunity to change that. Commit your life to him. Last this morning, I want to encourage you about your word. You can have the best preacher in all the world, Brother Norman. Good man. Godly man. Great preacher. And he can preach the best sermons in the whole wide world. And if you don't have a relationship with Jesus, all you're doing is going from Sunday to Sunday and getting a little bit of air put in that tire that's going flat every week.
That's right. Amen.
So my question is this morning, are you ready to take a moment, stop, take a breath, get a little of the blood circulation going, and spend some time with Jesus this week? Remember, we can't do anything about last week. But we can change it from here on.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord.
This morning, would you mind praying with me? If God's dealing with your heart, the invitation will be for the altar to be open for you. If you need to come to the altar, you may need to stay in your seat and just pray where you are. Then that's open to you. But I encourage you this morning, if God's dealing with your heart about getting saved, come, take me by the hand, let me walk you through the Scripture. If God is dealing with you about spending time with Him and becoming more of a Mary than a Martha, maybe this morning we need to listen a little better. Now, I don't want you coming up to me after church and saying, I am such a Martha. I don't care. I got to work on me. I got to fix the Martha in me to where I am both Mary and Martha. I listen and I help. I want to do ministry. Where's God got you going this morning? Every head bowed, every eye closed. Let's pray this morning. Our pianists, our music people are coming. As they come, let's pray. Father, I'm asking you to work in our hearts this morning. I'm asking you to help us to commit, to listen, to hear, to be obedient, to walk in it. And don't just let it happen in us. Let us be something that you're proud of. Help those that are seeking to make a change in their life by spending more time with you this morning. Help us to change this week what we couldn't change last week. And help me to become more like you by listening and hearing. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Will you stand with me this morning? If God's dealing with your heart, you come. God deals with you. You listen. Maybe some of you need to be praying this morning. It's okay. As Brother Andy leads us in an invitational hymn, I surrender all.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give.
I will ever love and trust Him. In His presence, what? Daily what? Live. Ooh, what a hymn. I surrender all.
I surrender all. I surrender all. All.
Brother Andy, I'm going to ask you to sing the second verse to this. I'm going to ask you, church, to pray for yourself first. Starting first, just you. Pray for yourself.
I surrender.
Then pray for your mate, your one right next to you, your friend, your buddy.
I bow, worldly pleasures all forsake. Take me, Jesus, take me. I surrender all.
I surrender all.
I surrender all.
All to Jesus.
All to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Hey, can we do something? Can we do that a cappella? All to Jesus
I surrender, all to Him I freely give.
I will ever love and trust.
trust Him.
Where are we going to live?
In His presence daily.
Sing it out, church. Sing it like you never sung it.
I surrender all.
Come on now.
I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender.